Welcome to Grace Fellowship Online. My name is Pastor TJ. I'm the youth pastor here at Grace Fellowship. And thank you so much for deciding to join us today. We're going to take just a few moments and we're going to worship together as a church family. So we want to encourage you to stand up, participate, and let's worship.
Amazing grace, this is amazing grace that you would take me. don't deserve it still. You give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. You only, only for you, God. You give life.
Thank you so much for connecting with us today. Would you take just a moment and fill out our digital connect card? And as you do that, we're going to continue to honor God in our giving and generosity. And today we're going to be talking about the word steward. What in the world is a steward? A steward is someone who manages or looks after someone else's resources. Look at what Jesus says in Luke 16, verse 10. Says, whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. See, whatever comes from God isn't just from Him. It ultimately belongs to Him. And the ultimate test of being a good steward does not come when we have plenty. It comes when we have little. So during this season, if you have little or plenty, are we being open and generous with what God has given us? Or are we being stingy and closing our fists and have a scarcity mindset because we're fearful of the future? We have an opportunity right now to sow into something that will ultimately change lives and help people during this season.
right now, as of right now, we have fed over 300 people over the last few weeks as a result of your generosity, people who are on the front lines of this crisis every single day. Not only that, we are helping people with rent, we're helping people with food, and we're even helping people with medical bills during this crisis, people who are struggling. And did you know that people are coming to know Jesus? People are being baptized, and people's lives are being changed forever as a direct result of your generosity. We have a tremendous opportunity right now to continue to see amazing things happen during, even during this season. Will you continue to partner with us? Would you guys pray with me? Father, thank you so much for who you are and what you're doing in every single one of our lives. Lord, thank you for this reminder in Luke 16, God, how if we are faithful with little, God, that you will entrust us with much. Lord, I pray that we would think about that as we give today and know that, God, our giving is directly tied to seeing people come to know you and having their lives changed forever. Lord, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now, as you give, we encourage you to click that Give Now button. And as you give, we're going to watch our Need to Know.
Hi, everybody. It's Jen McIntosh here, your guest services lead here at Grace Fellowship. And it's that time again. I'm bringing you the Need to Know. First, today is our annual celebration. We hope that everyone will join us back at noon for this amazing celebration via Zoom. God has been moving in and through Grace and all of its ministries. We're gonna be taking a look at the past year and all of the amazing moments and looking forward into what the new year holds. There will be a business meeting portion where we will go over the new budget and the members will be voting to approve it. Everyone is invited to this Zoom celebration. The Zoom info has been sent out to everyone through email. Second, our small groups have been doing amazing. It has been awesome to see how they are loving, supporting, and encouraging one another. It is never too late to join one of our amazing small groups. Just visit our website at findgrace.com, fill out the online form, and our small groups pastor, Pastor Monty, will reach out shortly. We want to do life together, and this is an amazing opportunity. And finally, we will be having a new series start on Mother's Day called Parenting Like a Boss. Woohoo! Parenting is messy and fun at the same time. So why not talk about it? This series will be lighthearted, exciting, and we'll have tips for everyone. Make sure you check out this new series starting on Mother's Day. That's it for me, guys. Until next week, see you later. Praying that you're all staying safe and healthy.
Someone there.
Potentially ending a year of political gridlock after three general elections failed to establish a ruling party. The proposed deal is expected to call for the rivals to rotate as prime minister, who again takes over next year. In
It's time to pay the price.
I'll do whatever it takes.
Please don't hurt her.
I'm gonna need some time, though.
Let me give you a little incentive to hurry up.
Talk, Mr. Carter.
No.
Give me a second, guys. Hey, Stirk, what's going on?
Oh, nice. Hey, how's your parents doing?
I gotta call you back.
We understand each other. So we're ready to pay the price now. Good. Leave the money at the address I sent you. Come alone. Drop it. Leave.
And then you'll let me go.
That's adorable.
It seems pretty obvious to me that if we were presented with the opportunity to escape, we'd take it. Yet, some people just don't take that step when it's presented. Why not? I mean, when it comes to addiction and drugs, we think, oh, just say no. Yet, they don't. Or we see people in a bad situation or a bad relationship, we say, why don't you just break it off? Why don't you just walk away? And yet, they stay. Well, a term that we've probably heard of but don't fully understand is a term called Stockholm Syndrome. It comes from an event that happened in Stockholm, Sweden in 1973. There was a botched bank robbery where the bank robbers got stuck, and so they held the people in the bank captive in a vault for 6 days. And over that 6 days, the people that were held hostage began to form these emotional bonds with the people that were holding them hostage. And after it was all resolved, the bank robbers went to jail. But what was most amazing about the experience was what followed. The people that were held hostage would not testify against the bank robbers. They wouldn't even press charges. The state had to do that. And then the thing that was most bizarre was that one of the captors wound up being engaged to the person who held them hostage. Now, that doesn't make sense to you or I. But the problem is, it's a very real disorder. And I think when it comes to the bondage of sin in people's lives, that we feel captive to our situation. We fall into sin and we kind of ease into it, but then it becomes our new normal. Ephesians 4:22 says, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires. You know, the interesting thing about sin is that it's very unexpected. Oftentimes, sin causes us to stay longer than we want to stay, go further than we plan to go, and it costs us more than we're willing to pay. See, we get comfortable in our sin. We get comfortable in our addictions. We get comfortable in our bad habits. And you would say, well, surely we know the way. And the truth is, a lot of people know what to do. They just don't have the power to make the change. And I believe that that's very true. According to the Bible, many of us don't really have the power to change. But we do have someone who can help us change. God loves us. God wants to guide us through the challenges that we face. God wants to help us when we struggle with not just Stockholm Syndrome, but Stockholm syndrome. John 14, 15 through 17 says, if you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. See, that's God's plan for us, that he doesn't want us to go through this alone. When people struggle with Stockholm syndrome, they often find themselves in years of counseling in order to rediscover their true identity and to discover the truth. The good news is that the Holy Spirit is that counselor, and God's plan is that the Holy Spirit would give us the power to change and guide us back to our true identity and the truth. We all know that there are things in our life that we need to change, but often we struggle with the power to make the change. We know we should start a new habit, but we lack the willpower to actually do something about it. We find ourselves saying things like, well, I'll start tomorrow, and tomorrow becomes next week, and next week becomes next year. And we find ourselves never really making the change. The reason why is because we lack the power. You know, I have this very small device called a cell phone, and it has the ability to connect to people all over the world. I can talk to anyone that I have access to. But what I found is that if I don't have it plugged in, if I don't have power in it, it's rendered useless. When you and I go through life without power to change, we feel hopeless and we feel like we can never get to where we're trying to go. But God offers the power source. Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. The amazing thing is that we're watching COVID-19 spread all over the world, a virus that's transmitted from person to person, and it's passive. Yet God offers the power of the Holy Spirit to change us and give us the power to change from within, and we can share that with person after person. And God has the ability to use his power of the Holy Spirit to bring about change faster than the spread of COVID-19. Not only does the Holy Spirit give us the power to change, but the Holy Spirit also helps us change our focus. And when we change our focus, we change our future. Because where we focus is going to determine where we go. Galatians 5, 16 through 17 says, so I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. The Holy Spirit has the power to change our hearts and to change our minds. And until we change the way we see ourselves, we'll never see a change in the world that God desires. God really wants to transform us. See, the Holy Spirit is a counselor that will guide us step by step to rediscover and reconnect with our Creator instead of our captor. See, it's easy for us to identify with our sin. So many times people who are struggling with addictions will say, hi, my name is Joe, and I'm an alcoholic. You know, that was my story. In college, I had a breakthrough. See, previously, I believed that I identified with Joe, the guy who drinks to numb his pain, or I'm Joe, the guy who would work hard to accomplish things, or I would identify as Joe, the guy who wasn't very good at relationships. But whenever God got a hold of my heart, I began to see myself as a child of God, and I began to think that my worth is not in what I do, but in whose I am. And God began to set me free. God began to refocus my attention. And instead of experiencing work ethic and hard work and hard knocks of life where I had to do this and do that in order to gain approval of other people, I began to experience grace, God's unmerited favor, where the Holy Spirit began to work in me and transform me, began to change the way that I would see things. God began to help me to love other people the way that God loved me, and relationships got better. I was able to say no to alcohol because I said yes to something bigger, something better, and it was Jesus. My life changed whenever the Holy Spirit changed my focus onto God, my Creator, instead of the crutches that I had relied on in the past. when we quit identifying with our captors and we start to identify with our Creator, lives begin to change. And God wants to lead us through that change. See, what's really scary is sometimes people think, I just don't have what it takes. And you know, you're totally right. None of us have what it takes, but God does. If we'll just trust the Holy Spirit to guide us, we'll discover that the Holy Spirit has the power to change. And God's not gonna force himself on us. God's not gonna push us into a situation. In fact, the Message version of Ephesians 3:20 says, God can do anything, you know, far more than you could ever imagine or hope in your wildest dreams. And he does it not by pushing us around, but by his Spirit working deeply and gently within us. Whenever I begin to realize that God wants us to experience grace, it began to change my life from the inside out. And I believe that God wants to transform your life as well. You could see a counselor if you were struggling with Stockholm Syndrome, but all of us have access to a free counselor 24/7, and their name is the Holy Spirit. John 14:26 says, "The counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." God's word tells us that the Holy Spirit is a counselor, but it also tells us that he is the Spirit of truth. And when you allow the Holy Spirit to work in you and through you, you will begin to identify not with your captor, not with your sin, but with your Creator. John 8:32 says, "Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." When we know the truth will set us free. Let's pray. God, I pray for people that struggle and identify with their sin, that they think that they identify with their problems instead of identifying with their Creator. God loves us more than the messes that we've made. In fact, God meets us right in our mess, and he transforms our mess into a message. The message is that God can do anything, and the Holy Spirit can work within us to change our focus, change our heart, and change our desires to focus on the things of God instead of the things that we desire in the flesh. God, I pray that you would work in people and that you would set people free. And as people say, God, I admit that I have sin in my life and that I need your Holy Spirit to come within me and guide me, that Jesus, you would send the Holy Spirit and that they would experience that power to change and a change of focus that changes their future. God, we love you and we trust you, and we know that you're in the business of changing lives. If you just prayed that prayer, I hope that you'll take a moment and click the button that says, "I made a decision for Jesus." We want to walk with you on this journey. You're not alone. We're in this together. The Holy Spirit is going to guide you, but we're going to walk this out with you step by step. We're going to send you resources so that you can know what to do next. Just because your identity changed doesn't mean that you don't have steps to take. And we want to make that crystal clear. We want to help you live the life that God's called you to, and we want you to experience a life of freedom. Thanks so much for being a part of this experience, and we hope you will experience grace.
Thank you so much for deciding to join us today. If you gave your life to Jesus, we are so excited. We are celebrating with you, and we want you to know that we're here for you. So if you gave your life to Jesus, please let us know by clicking "I commit my life to Jesus" button. We just want to celebrate with you, connect with you, and give you some free resources for your new faith. If you found this message or even this service helpful, share it with your friends, your family, or your coworkers online. We hope you have a great rest of your week. We hope to see you next week, and we hope you experience grace.